Welcome to the DIY Video for Professionals podcast. Today's guest is the wonderful Morgan Nelson. He's a master trainer in neuro-linguistic programming, nearly a decade of exploring human psychology and neuroscience. Morgan rewires people's minds for a more successful, joyous, clearer life, and he's having an absolute blast along the way, as you'll hear. He's got one of the top self-development entrepreneurial podcasts. It travels the globe. He shares his secrets of rapid growth and conquering mental barriers. And his events, oh man, his events are just truly inspiring. I was so grateful to have him on. Make sure you go and check out his podcast at Dream Out Loud. But before you do, here's my interview with Morgan Nelson.
You know, I'm 30 years old now. When I finished school, the only reason I went to all the way to grade 12 was for the parties and the girls. That was the only two reasons I went there, because I didn't really enjoy school. Like most entrepreneurs, you know, I really think it is like this. There's a sign now you can see an entrepreneur in the beginning, like a telltale sign to say that person will be an entrepreneur. They can't focus. They don't like to follow authority, and they don't usually finish tasks. They don't do the tests. They don't do things, because I start to instantly see from the beginning. I'm like, I understand I need to do this test. Sure. You want me to do this test? You're the teacher. Sure. But I'd have no idea why striving for an A in this maths test is genuinely going to really help me in life. Maths, possibly. Like, you can become really good at maths. You can maybe good. You can probably be good at finance, good career, sure. But these other subjects that were just pushing me so hard to be good at, I was like, I just didn't understand it. When am I ever going to need to use most of these things you're making me do? And I would just go, I would see that and be like, this doesn't make sense. This is not going to support me in life. So I would focus on things that were more practical. But the teachers didn't like that. So when we finished grade 12, they said to me that if you don't pull your head in, essentially, then we're going to expel you before the end of the year, which happened at the end of the year, was the formal and the graduation. And I'm like, yo, you can't kick me out of the biggest party of the decade. That's the only reason I've stayed to year 12 for the party, right? And so I did what I had to do, and I stayed around, but I graduated with one of the worst scores you can possibly get, to having one of my teachers tell me that, we recommend when you leave school, we recommend you don't do anything in reading, writing, journalism, or public speaking, because that's not your strong suit. Go do something where you can trade time for money. Go become a tradie, mechanic, a builder, or something like that. And now, you know, I'm writing my first book. I speak all around the world. I have a global podcast. I interview people for a living. I speak for a living. You know, and so I kind of went against everything that they told me again. But the first early years in life, I was doing what they told me to do. So I went and became a carpenter. I was an apprentice carpenter. And I realized that I didn't really enjoy this life. I didn't understand working 6 days a week, 10 to 12 hours a day, doing something that didn't really light my soul on fire, that didn't make any sense to me. I was like, there's no way I can't do this for the rest of my life. So I started to look outside the box. I started to look for who's the people around me that make the most money, the developers, the builders. So I stayed on that sort of trajectory where I was focusing on wanting to become a builder. Through the process of all that, got dragged into the toxic lifestyle of the tradie life, carpentry, all these sorts of things. Drinking alcohol every single day, needing alcohol to go to sleep every night, using drugs every single day to wake up, keep going, go to sleep every night. 19 years old, try to take my own life, because I was extremely depressed, extremely anxious, had no idea that happiness was even a thing I could achieve. And I remember getting to the point in my life thinking that it was like it was my first attempt. It was like I came out of the gate after school and I tried my best and I got here and I was like the end of the line. And it genuinely felt like, man, this is it. Like, fuck, good shot, but this sucked. And it was, I remember thinking like, well, just end it all, because you've already failed. And I really didn't think that it could be anything else. And looking back now, it's funny when you're like 19, 20, and you're in 20s, you think that's your whole life. And so it kind of like woke me up a bit to realize that what I was doing right now didn't make me happy. I left that whole environment. I came back down to the Gold Coast and I just focused on doing two things. One, anything that would actually bring joy to my life, anything that would make me happy. But then B, surrounding myself with people that actually had the life I wanted, because I started to realize that there was a correlation between unhappy people and mediocrity. I started to realize that a lot of people that were just normal in life that had the results that I didn't want, they were also unhappy. And the other correlation, the people who had an incredible, extraordinary life, they were really happy. And I started to focus on just getting myself around those happy and successful people, thinking that maybe I can start to learn a thing or two. And I never forget my friend, he gave me a CD by the name, by a guy by the name of Jim Rohn. And I used to listen to it every single day on the drive to work. And this was my first ever insight to personal development. And he started saying things like, you're the sum of the five people you surround yourself with the most. Don't wish life was easier, wish you were better. And all these sorts of things. He's like, you know, it's you know, and he would, and he even, I remember this analogy he gave. He's like, the ambitious sower, the goal of life, he's like, you should become the ambitious sower. Like a farmer doesn't go out there and just plant a few seeds and hopes that the seed's gonna grow into this extraordinary tree. He goes out there every single day and just focuses on planting the seeds. And then knowing that sometimes the seeds are going to grow on shallow ground and go nowhere. Some seeds will grow on hard ground and not even penetrate the earth. Some seeds will grow and then the first bit of wind that comes over, they'll wither and die. But eventually, if you keep planting seeds, the seed will fall on perfect soil, perfect ground, and it will grow into one of the most incredible pieces of fruit, vegetables, whatever it is, right? And all these things start to get planted in my mind. I started to completely change my philosophy of how I viewed the world. I was no longer sort of thinking about, oh, you know, life was so hard for me. Why am I broke? Why can't things work? I would start focusing on going, how can I wish for bigger problems? I had a different perspective to problems. A lot of people wish that their problems can go away. I don't want my problems to go away. I want my problems to actually get bigger. I want to handle big problems. I want to handle big problems because I'm a sick fuck. But here's the thing. Most, like, we're all going to have problems though. Like, we all have problems. But I would rather solve problems that pay millions than problems that just fix my house or whatever. You know what I mean? I never forget my friend's got a multiple, he's got an 8-figure business. And he comes into the gym one day and his trainer is there and his trainer says to him, he's like all flustered, his hands are on his hip and he's looking upset. And Sash says to him, he's like, what's wrong? And he's like, oh, well, look at me. He says, yeah, what's up? And he's like, well, look what I'm wearing. And he goes, what are you wearing? He's like, my clothes. And he goes, I didn't get it. And he goes, I've had the worst week of my life. And he goes, what's happened? He goes, my washing machine broke. And he goes, okay, anything else? He goes, no, that's it. He's like, what do you mean, is there anything else? And he goes, can I give you some advice? You got to wish for bigger fucking problems. And it's so true. I think a lot of people go around trying to hope that their dishwasher, that their washing machine doesn't break. But I'm trying to focus on bigger problems that, because you solve big problems, they pay a lot more. Solve rich people problems and you'll get paid a lot of money. Solve poor people problems and you stay poor.
We'll be back with Morgan Nelson in just a moment. The reason you're hearing this podcast so clearly is because we've incorporated this. If you're on our YouTube channel, go and have a look at the quality that comes out of what we call the desktop video studio and allows professionals just like yourself an ability to have camera, sound, lights, teleprompter, all at a single switch of a button and all at the convenience of your desk. Let's have a listen to a couple of happy clients who are using this system.
Get people that come to my masterclasses and the first thing they do is they go, wow. And they know I'm here to get good value.
It has saved me a day, a month. Yeah, I now use video more because it's just easier to do.
The equipment is just incredible. It's easy. You're ready to go.
Being able to come in here, turn it on and look down the barrel is just so good.
I can take a little bit more time with the delivery because there is no setup. Coming across more professionally, got to have a look at it. You are getting massive value.
Oh my God, I'm like wishing that all these years I would have saved myself time. It's just so much better. It was such a great investment. I can shoot videos like that.
You can switch it on, do a really fast message within 2 minutes. Having the best tools has taken my business to the next level.
If you want more information on how you can do this for yourself, go to ridgefilms.com.au/DIY.
And, you know, so I started to kind of focus on all these things, surround myself with different people. I was 21 years old, I started doing those things. And by the age of 23, I had my first business, online business. I was financially free. We were making over 6 figures a year residually. So passive income completely online. And then I grew that into, we're doing 7 figures a year on sales. We had customers and we had about 6,000 customers, nearly 20, I think 19 countries around the world. And I built it all from the beaches of Mexico at 23 to 24 years old, that was what I focused on. And what really started to click on my head was a lot of people started to ask me, how on earth did you do that? A few years ago, you're broke, you're unhappy, you try to take your own life, you got no idea what's going on, you're not an entrepreneur, you never even went to university, you barely finished school. How did you grow this business? And I said, I don't know. And I got absolutely fascinated and obsessed on how we do the things we do. Like, why do people do the things they do? I got obsessed on neuroscience, psychology, behavioral psychology, neuro-linguistic programming, hypnotherapy, all these sorts of things that make people do the things they do. And then how can we actually provide tools to help people change and transform over time? Because some people think that we can't change, which I completely disagree. I think the essence of a human being is to continually transform and grow day after day, year after year. I think the number one reason why people are so upset when their birthday rolls back around each year is because it reminds them that they have spent another year on this earth without growing. Right? I get really excited when my birthday comes around because I'm like, holy shit, we're in such a different position this year to what we were last year. It should continually be this goal, this growth thing. And you know, that's been a huge thing we've focused on since then. Right? So at 24, I traveled all around the world and taught from stages up to 6,000 people, teach them secrets of your mind. And now I've sort of created this thing called the Dream Out Loud Method, which is the four laws of designing your dream life. And then I've now birthed that from, it started as a 10-minute talk. I did a video one day on social media. First video I ever did. I did a video, I was shitting myself, sound like a bogan because I was still a carpenter. I'm like, I think I'm onto something. You know, there's this thing and these pillars. And fast forward now, you know, now we run workshops, seminars with anywhere up to like nearly 100 people in the room. Our next one will have nearly 100 in the room. Come spend 3 whole days with us where we take them through an insane transformation process. And I essentially teach them everything I've done in the last decade, but we give it to them in 3 days. That's exactly what you just went through. So that's kind of what I've dedicated my whole life to now, is creating online education, seminars, programs, helping people rewire their unconscious mind and put it back in a way that they want to gear them for a much more successful, happy, purposeful life.
And I love the Dream Out Loud method. I thought it was amazing. And I probably had a sense of skepticism. I even spoke with one of the guys there beforehand. I'm like, oh, yeah, you know, we'll be out of here before you know it or whatever. We're just having a bit of a banter. And
next minute, you're sucked in. You're like, oh, my God.
Well, you know, like I was excited, you know, man. You know, I hate to bring this back to this kind of age thing, but you know, you're a young bloke and I've seen you and you're talking the talk and all of that. And I still carried a sense of, I guess, jealousy to some degree. You know, I don't think I'm a overly jealous type, and I understand the whole, you know, removing people from pedestals and all that type of stuff. It was just, How does this guy get this amount of people in a room who would are obviously going through some sort of transition, but at some point they decide they're going to put their money down and do it? And the people that I was meeting, the other members that I was meeting there were coming from like northern Queensland and leaving their family behind, and you know, they were blue collar workers and they were just doing their thing, and then here they are for an intensive weekend away. And I found that really interesting. And I guess the question to you is like the repeat of people's lives, the every year being the same, where does that penny drop for somebody? And they go, fuck, you know, I'm going to just fucking go. I'm going to, you know, make a start on this, you know, because ultimately I think for you, you do have a great start at people that have put their money down. So at some point they've made a decision to get in that room, right? It's not like you've dragged them off the street and said, hey, come and listen to me. Where does the penny drop for people? What's the aggravant that kind of gets them to put their money down and go, right, I'm kind of come and listen?
Yeah, well, people will do things for multiple different reasons. But if we talk about like what takes someone to actually completely transform their life, up until the age of 25, psychologists have shown that up until the age of 25, it's quite easy for someone to change their life, right? That's why also a lot of my marketing is geared towards youngers, 20 to kind of 40 people, right? It's the age group. And because it's easier, right? You get someone who's 23 years old, they haven't gone through enough trauma in life yet. They haven't gone through enough years of kickbacks, failures, being fired, being broken up with, going through a divorce, as the average 50-year-old. They just don't have it. They have half a year's worth of being beaten down than someone who's 50. So under the age of 25, it's quite simple. You can show them a better vision for their life because they're still really programmable. You can show them more of a hopeful future. This is what you could create. Is this what you want? Yes. Like it's more, there's less baggage then, okay? But after the age of 25, people might be thinking, well, what creates change after 25? The answer is people up often over the age of 25 won't create severe transformational change in their life without going through some sort of trauma. So what takes people, and I'll break this down in a second. So let's say, for example, you went through a hectic situation in your life last year, yes?
Yeah.
Did you create any sort of major, I don't know if you've told your audience about it or not, but did you create any major sort of life-changing decisions in that moment or since then? Have you made any life-altering?
Immediately. So in emergency. So yeah, my audience does know, but it was in emergency, like an hour later, where I was like, fuck.
Yeah. So man, what did you decide?
That I didn't want to waste time.
Yes.
Making decisions was probably the primary thing. What are we waiting for? Mm-hmm. It was kind of like I was still plugged up to all the machines, but I still had that motivation to go, fuck, yeah, let's go, you know? And I guess coming out of hospital so quickly as well, I was out within 48 hours. But yeah, I was fucking motivated, ready to go.
Yep. So that's a perfect situation. You were probably waiting for the right time for a while. Maybe you were 99% issue. You're still doing things because I know you're quite successful. You're doing things. But then that happened and you're like, whoa, major wake up, major traumatic change in your life where you're like, shit's real. Different path in your life completely. That's what people need to go through. But I'm not saying, before people get too depressed and go and try to kill themselves, let's break it down a little bit, okay? Because if someone's like, oh, but I'm 30, I'm 50, what do you mean? I have to wait till I have a heart attack for me to change? My wife has to leave me? Potentially not, if you're aware of it, okay? Because I also remember you came to the event because your wife was coming to the event and you were like, well, I'll come with you because what if she grows more than me and what, we've got to grow together, right? What would have been driving your decision to be there was the fear of potentially losing your partner. Well, what if she becomes so much bigger or smarter or whatever and we grow apart, right? So we're continually being motivated by one or two things, gaining pleasure or avoiding pain. That's it. But because one of the most important things of our unconscious mind, its primary job is to keep us alive. That's it. And avoid threats. But in a million years ago, the threats were someone might come into our cave and kill us. We might get attacked by a tiger. This day and age, the threats are, well, if my wife goes to a personal development seminar and she grows without me, she might realize that I'm not growing fast with her. Nah, that's perceived pain. Like, that's enough for me to take action. I'm going to get my ass there as well and I'm going to go.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. So at any given time, people are continually taking action towards what they think is best. But the unfortunate thing is what most people think is best is usually because they've avoided pain, but in the moment, they've decided on something that they don't actually want, but what they want will endure potential pain or discomfort. So they will settle for what they don't want because it gives them what they really don't want, which is some sort of pain, if that makes sense. So for example, let's take someone who's 30 kilos overweight. They're overweight for a reason. They ate the wrong foods for a long period of time. They haven't hit a gym in a long time. Because I get it. I don't like going to the gym. In fact, I hate it. I hate going to the gym, spending an hour of my time getting sweaty, lifting heavy shit. I would rather go and sit on the beach. Way easier. I don't like it. And some people are like, oh, I love going to the gym. Yeah, maybe because you've done it for so long where now you've got a different association to it where you perceive pain for not working out. You enjoy that. But for me, I don't like it. But let's take someone 30 kilos overweight. They haven't worked out in a long time. But now I say to them, okay, if you want to be really fit and healthy and attract the girl of your dreams, you've got to go on a super strict diet and hit the gym 2 times a day. Now they're like, well, that's a pleasurable outcome. But in order for me to get it, I got to do 2 things I really don't want to do. I got to give up Ben and Jerry's. I got to diet. I got to go to the gym. That sounds painful. That sounds horrible. Screw that. I'm going to stay exactly where I am because that sounds like a better option. I'm going to stay here and be miserable and be unhappy because I would rather be unhappy than go through what I think will be extremely painful. So every single time people are doing what they think is best and it comes down to because they're doing whatever they need to do to avoid pain because avoiding pain is about 11 times more motivating than seeking pleasure. Because every room I've ever been in, I said, put up your hand if you want to make $1 million this year. Everyone's hands goes up. Put up your hand if you'd love it, if you could live on the beach for the rest of your life, have complete freedom of your of all choice in your life, no boss, no worries, and live forever. Everyone's hands go up. So why aren't you in an absolute insane mission to achieve that? And then people bring up all their reasons. Oh, well, because I'm afraid. Well, I'm afraid of succeeding. I'm afraid of failing. I'm afraid of what people might think of me. They're the three primary things. So people are afraid to succeed, and then they're afraid to fail. So they're afraid if they win, they're afraid if they don't win. So they stay exactly where they are because they're like, well, this is the safest place. But then what happens is they now get a payoff of being a victim. So they go, oh, well, then they'll justify and convince themselves as to why they can't do it, why they're not like their parents, why they're not like their friends, because they're too old, they're too young, they're too white, they're too black, they're too feminine, they're too masculine, they're too this, they're too that. It's the wrong time, it's the right time, it's the left time, it's the whatever. Insert all the excuses. So here's the thing. People aren't getting the things they want because they're completely boxed in by their limitations. But if we fight for our limitations, we'll keep them. So if we're going to fight for our limitations and say, well, these are all the reasons why we can't have them, then by all means, you'll buy them and they belong to you. But you could also fight for the argument to the limitations. Well, I don't believe I'm good enough. Well, hang on a second. Why would you believe that? Like, you could question these sorts of things as well. So I guess the reason you ask, why would people want to go do these things? For so many different reasons. But primarily, they're avoiding pain in the future or now, and they're wanting to seek pleasure. And what I always try to do is to get people to have a new association to, if you don't continue, so if you don't do what you want to do right now, then ultimately it will give you the most painful life. So I get them to associate massive pain in the future that, hey, if I keep doing the bad thing, then it's going to be worse off in 10 years. So I might as well bite the bullet right now and do what's hard now so life can be easy versus doing what's easy now because then life will be hard. So that's the primary reason what really motivates people. And then based off their own individual values as well. Most people who come to events like with me, they value success, they value wealth, they value money, they value growth, they value fun, they value learning, these sorts of things. Our values are some of the most deeply rooted unconscious psyche that really motivates all human beings. Like, we will take action that's what's towards things that are in alignment with the things that are most important to us, which are our values. So you might have met people, you might have gone to the event and be like, this is amazing, everybody should do it. And then Sally, who you work with potentially, she's like, oh, that sounds horrible. I don't want to do that. Because on her weekends, what she wants to do is just go get drunk with the girls. She might just value that. That might be her value. Okay. And who's right, who's wrong? Because at the end of the day, if you're living a life in your values, then that's a purposeful life. I don't think that everyone should do our program. I think if they did it, their life would be better. But at the end of the day, I'm not here to sort of convince people. But the question was, what makes people do the things they do? In a nutshell, everything we do is an alignment of things that are important for us, our values, who we believe we are at our core, and some very deep-rooted, unconscious, avoiding some sort of pain. But that's why people get into downward spirals of really bad unconscious patterns and behaviors. People will cheat, people gamble. They'll do these sorts of things that they know are bad, but they don't know why they do it. And deep down, they're doing it because they're avoiding some sort of pain. I forget who said it. There was a famous quote where it's like, most of man's problems exist in his inability to sit quietly with himself. Most people will discover all of their problems if they can just actually sit quietly, because a lot of people don't do that. And they go and distract themselves with vices and things because they're avoiding something deep under the surface.
Last time you met with me, you brought up the lack of personal brand. And I reported back on it. I started walking in the park like my wife and doing my social media videos and starting to free flow thoughts and not give a shit about what people are saying, is really just dump a whole bunch of information down. Part of the reason for not doing those types of videos in the past is because I'm a professional. I want to look professional. I want to say that everything that comes out of my mouth is high value and, you know, coherent and important to people. When I published those videos, I actually mentioned you, by the way. I published those videos like, Morgan said I don't have a personal brand, so that's why I'm here. You have a look. It's on LinkedIn. But what I started to find is like a whole bunch of people that were experiencing the same thing and that were sort of turning up and saying, yeah, I can see what you're trying to do. I can see how like the, you know, you could be limited by that. But I know it's its own pandemic, this whole concept of going on camera and like, you know, playing in a energy field, let's call it, on social media that's actually there for people. It's free, it's available. Like they just need to overcome some of the barriers that they have for whatever reason. They can't talk, they don't like themselves on camera, they can't string a sentence together, they don't believe they have any value to have. Where do you, I suppose, with everything that you've just talked about, how could that relate to somebody that actually is suffering from that, you know, that problem of increasing their visibility to their market in the form of video?
Like somebody who wants to do that but is afraid of judgment, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I guess look at the example of LinkedIn, right? A highly corporatized social platform. You know, it's like people publish, hey, this is my award. Hey, this is our luncheon. This is our special event that we did for charity. Mm-hmm. It's like fucking boring as shit, right? Like let's call it for what it is. it's phenomenal what a polarizing difference in terms of time on LinkedIn versus binge-worthy time on TikTok. You know, spend 20 minutes on the dunny on TikTok and like 1 minute just having a quick doom scroll on LinkedIn, right? Yet I see it as a massive opportunity because it's so underutilized. It's there's nobody there publishing real shit and talking to people like humans and, you know, being vulnerable and wearing their heart on their sleeve and just telling things in a that may not be directly related to video, just personal stories that are all about creating connection points.
Yeah.
Knowing that, where do you think what do you think is stopping the professional, if you like, probably the best way to describe it, like the professional to kind of break down some of those professional barriers and go, fuck it, I'll give this a go.
It's social norms, a social construct, you know, and there's been it's based off why we do the things we do. So if we look at the first ever psychological test that Harvard University have ever done on human beings, when they first started study psychology, they're like, I want to test these weird creatures called humans. Why do we do the things we do? And what they did was they put four lines on a board and they picked three fake actors to come in and one real person. They put four lines. One of the lines was double the size of the other lines. And all they said to them was, put a circle around which one here is different. And the three actors were told, come in and put a line around the wrong one. So they said, all of you have to select A, but the answer is C. So they select A and the real guy comes in and he's like, what the hell? And he circles C. He's like, this is weird. You guys, the fuck are you talking about, right? Circles C. But then they reshuffled and they did it again. They told the actors, go in there and choose B this time. Omer comes in and he starts to doubt himself a little bit more. They do this for about four, five, six times. By the time it gets to the sixth time, nearly every time they've done it, what happens is the real guy will come in and actually circle the wrong answer, but he'll do it. He'll copy the exact same answer as the actors. And what they've shown is time and time and time again that us as human beings, we will eventually do what the rest of the people around us are doing, even if we know it's not the right answer, but we'll do it because unconsciously it's more important for us to fit in than it is for us to actually stand out and be right. It's more important for us because if we think back to the primal days, we have three parts of our brain. The primal thing drives all of our habits and our actions before we even know what's happening. And if you think back to a million years ago, we were safer when we were in a tribe. If you go out hunting, you got to stay with your tribe. That's how you're going to stay alive. And that has transitioned into the modern world as we will do what most people around us are doing. And so if we're looking at like, say, LinkedIn, like most people, because I don't even do anything on LinkedIn. To be honest, my personality is probably not a good fit on LinkedIn. But like if we look at something like that, people are going to go around and they're going to do what most people are doing. But they're not even going to question what most people are doing because they just think, well, that's the way it has to get done. And if I do anything other than that, even if I think I'm right, most of the time they're not going to do it because they're going to feel like they're leaving the tribe unconsciously. They're going to feel like, well, I can't stand alone.
You got to ask yourself, are you satisfied with the way that you're presenting yourself and your personal brand to your market? And for 4 years now, people have been really struggling to clarify the way they look and sound on camera when it comes to doing video calls and recording their own personalized videos. And there is a solution. The DIY video program helps you personalize sales video and emails, record professional marketing videos, look and sound amazing in every video meeting without the tech hassles. And you also get professional video editing and practical training so that you can present like a pro. You don't have to do anything in that initial setup because the studio is installed for you. You get your coaching and the training so that you can then go on and be a video professional and wipe out poor quality videos forever. Why don't you go to ridgefilms.com.au/DIY and check it out for yourself.
Okay, and not everyone, like I did a video about it and went super viral and had a bunch of people being like, I wouldn't do that. I would just choose the right answer. I'm like, possibly you would. Probably not every single person would do this. I would say that the people who have a healthy level of self-esteem would probably stick with their answer knowing that they're correct. They'd be like, you can be wrong all you want. I know what I know. But this requires a large level of self-trust. And because self-trust has to come with, I'm happy to stand alone. I don't need the tribe. I can stand alone. But we're talking 1% to 3% of the population probably who have done this sort of deep work. So the major thing you're looking at is every single time people are doing what they think is the best thing to do in the moment to survive, period. Mm. That's it. The unfortunate thing is nearly every single thing we do, about 95% of our behavior is completely unconscious and you don't know why you do it. So people be like, why are you doing videos like that? Oh, because you got to. Says who? Don't know. Some unconscious thing that people say, that's how you do it over here. Because people just think if they're going to go out on their own, it's dangerous. They're going to be unsafe. You know, that's kind of the major thing. And then I think just a lot of people, here's the thing. There was another quote. Thinking is hard. Carl Jung said this. Carl Jung sort of invented psychology. Carl Jung said, thinking is hard. That's why most people judge. Thinking is hard. That's why most people judge. And if you want to be in the world of branding and social media and putting content out there, you've got to be in the thinking game. You've got to think, you've got to analyze, you've got to take action. Some of my videos have gone off and got so much hate on there. And my team were like, oh my God, you're getting so much hate. I said, that's good. At least they're talking about me. At least they're talking about me. Because all my old haters like my content now. So this means we've got a new audience. I'd rather them talk about me. I'd rather them put hate on my comments than nothing. Right? Mm. But I'm looking at it from a thinking game. I'm like, they also have a small brain because why else would anyone sit on social media and throw hate on a random person's content? You must have a small size brain. That's okay. It's not their fault. Mm. Okay? Mm. But like, this is something I think about a lot as well. A lot of people get caught up in the perceived possible judgment from their peers. Mm. Because if we're seen to go do something left when most people are going right, they're going to have people go like, what are you doing? What's the guy? And everyone's going to go through the path as well. If you want to get to a place that's successful. The only reason people cheer and celebrate for people that are successful is because we all know what that motherfucker had to go through to get there. We all know it's admirable because we're like, whoa, that's incredible. Like the guy just broke the world record. He ran from the top of Africa to the bottom of Africa. It took him nearly an entire year. He ran... I don't know if you saw that. He ran 365 days in a row, I think. And he did, I think it was like 380 marathons, the equivalent. He'd run over a marathon every day for nearly an entire year through Africa. Crazy. Become like a world hero. People are like, oh my God. The only reason he's become a world hero is because everyone knows that is gnarly to go through that. And I don't want to go through that. So far out. If I think that's so crazy, I wouldn't want to go through that. But we make the judgment now based off where he is, the success. But what about day one when he says to everyone around him, I'm going to run 365 days in a row over a marathon every day and hope I don't die through Africa. People would have been like, you're an idiot. You're crazy. What do you think about it? You can't do it. Your body's going to die. You're going to get shot. You get robbed, which he did. He got robbed. You're going to get robbed. You can't do this. It's crazy. Blah, 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 blah. All the reasons. So we don't hear that now because now we're looking at it from the perspective of he's the successful hero. And most people who will throw rocks in the beginning will come back in the end and go, oh, I always knew you could do it. And the reason why it's such an admirable place to get to is because people are actually unconsciously aware that far out, I don't have the balls to do what you just did. So hats off to you. But are you willing to go through what most people go through from the moment one person judges you to the moment where people come up to you on the street and be like, can I take a photo with you? That is the biggest difference there. And you will be walking alone for the majority of that journey. So it comes down to a huge self-trust thing, knowing where you're going and having a good bunch of people around you too.
Are you happy to be wrong?
Yeah. Yeah. Because it shows me feedback. I'm very happy to be wrong. In fact, like I try to find things that are wrong quickly. I change things very fast. I'm like a mad scientist. Every time I meet with any of my team, they probably love it. And they probably also like, fuck me. Because I'll come in and change things. If it's working really good, keep doing it. But if things aren't working as fast yet, change it, change it, change it, change it, change it. Because what I say, and they might say things like, Morgan, I'm going to go do this. I said, why would you do that? They said, well, you told me to do that last week. Really? Yeah, I go, okay. Well, now I think last week Morgan was wrong. So do this now instead. We're always, like everyone's wrong. Like we're all making up shit as we go along. If you're afraid to be wrong, if you're afraid to be wrong, you're just chasing perfectionism, which doesn't exist anyway. Like, because everything is perfect, even all the wrong things, which then in itself, if it's wrong, would make it perfect. Because things have been wrong in the past, which has led us to breakthroughs in the future. And if we never got it wrong in the past, we never would have got the breakthrough now. So that in itself, the failure was perfect. So I embrace it. I love it.
Do you think in society, I guess in general, that the concept of failing is good is prevalent enough?
I think it could be stronger. And this would be, I would like to see what happens in like another 50 years. I think there's a huge generational change at the moment. I think a lot of younger people are really understanding that failing isn't the end of the world. But then again, you know, I could just be biased because it's my world. I could say, yeah, a lot of people are waking up knowing that failure is bad, but I think it's also extremely ingrained in us. Cause if we think, where did it come from? If you think back to school, when you screwed up and you got a wrong grade, if you failed a subject, what would happen? You get punished. You fail. You're the dumb kid. You got to resit the exam. Or this goes home to your parents and your parents give you like, what happened, little Johnny? Now you have to get detention. Maybe you have to get a tutor. Maybe you drop down a class. All these things, the shame in it, detached from the group, the clan, all these things. So we have so many perceptions of failure is the worst thing ever. So we'll do anything to avoid failure. But in the real world, especially in business, we know that we've got to embrace failure. Failure is a prerequisite for success because failure is nothing other than feedback. You see, I love to fail. Like I want to fail as fast and as hard as possible because that's just going to give me more reasons faster. I'm going to get more evidence, more data than anybody else for more ways to make it work next time. But if I delay that failure, I'm delaying the progress of everything. Look at Elon Musk. How many rocket ships has he blown up? He's like, and I actually saw a video. There was a video of inside their space station of all their team watching the first rocket go up. And it went up and it fucking exploded right away. And guess what all of their team were doing? Celebrating. They were celebrating. You'd think that everyone would be like, oh my God, we spent billions of dollars and investors' money in this and we failed. Oh, it's a miserable. They were celebrating. Different perspective completely. The most successful people celebrate their way through failures versus avoiding it.
There's definitely not enough businesses and entrepreneurs and people that I meet at least that talk about failure as winning. Like it's just, you know, unless they're right into self-help and listening to loads of podcasts.
Because a lot of business owners shouldn't be the entrepreneur. A lot of people get into business not because they're good at business or they're an entrepreneur. They get into business because they don't want a job. And, you know, you've got to realize like there's also a different risk. Like we have different risk thresholds. I'm a high risk taker. Like I'm a skydiver as well. I went jumping out of airplanes yesterday, all morning, jumping out multiple times with nothing but a backpack. Like that lights me up. I get so much fun from that. So I will push the tolerance so far. But that's why I squeeze the juice out. But a lot of people aren't built for that. I don't know what makes me like that. A lot of people don't have a risk tolerance like that. But that's also why I employ people that are very low risk so they can mitigate risks and make sure that we don't screw up too many things. Okay. But yeah, like I agree. I think only as many business owners think about that as they should, but it's also because they're probably the wrong person in the wrong seat. They start the business and they think that they should still be the CEO. You can start a business and hire a CEO and get out of the way. Billionaire, what's his name? Ben Francis, billionaire founder of Shark, Gymshark. He's young, he's 30. So I think he's about 30 actually. He started Gymshark and had the humility to actually go, you know what? I'm not qualified to be the CEO of this company. And he stood down and he hired a CEO. Then he went and worked as each role in each department for the next, I think, like 6 years or something, until then he felt more skilled enough to step back in as CEO. See, that's someone who can actually take their ego out of business. Too many people have ego in business and it fucks them up.
I love this, man. I love it. I'm super fucking pumped. I know that you're motivating a shitload of people by being you and repeating your message, you know, the stuff that you know. The Dream Out Loud method that we went to, my wife and I went to, is just such a great ride for an entire weekend. And we're talking big, long days right into the night. And I remember after we spoke in our one-on-one session afterwards, you said, when people are around me, they seem to make money. And then I came to your event in Double Bay and we signed with Lloyd Ross, who is an expert in investing. And so we're going through his course and we'll be back up to see you again, I think in October for the Money Mastery.
We just ran that on the weekend, actually.
Yeah. That we couldn't get to that one, but we're super pumped to get through, and we've started our investing journey and all this stuff.
I love it.
No idea what the fuck we're doing, but we're getting there. We're getting there.
You're in good hands there with Lloyd.
yeah, I love so, it. You know, what you said right at the beginning of this podcast around just surrounding yourself with the right amount of people, the right people, being in the room where people know way more than you do, being the smallest person in the room, those types of things really resonated with me. I just want to say, man, it was just a real pleasure to have you accept the invitation to come on. I know we haven't talked a hell of a lot about video, but hey, go to another episode. You'll hear shitloads about video. This one, you know, is a universal podcast for everybody, you know, young and old. And I'd really encourage that if you are inactive or you are you fail to take action and do things and pivot and move in a way that you want to move, then create a bit of friction in your life, and maybe that needle will move.
I love it.
Yeah, well, you know, that's my little motivational quote for the afternoon. Hey.
You know, if people love this, like I have a whole podcast they can check out called Dream Out Loud. It's always personal development, business, mindset. Interview some awesome people on there. Or my Instagram, they can find me, Morgan T. Nelson. You know, actually, I got something gangster for these guys. Just message my assistant, they'll send it to you. But we can give these guys like I got a planner. Like I created this planner, like a life by design planner. Because here's the thing. I know a lot of successful people, but they don't have a lot of life. And I wouldn't call them successful. Like there's seven different areas of wealth. One of them is time. Financial is one area of wealth. The other one is time, right? There's five others. So if you don't have time freedom as well, then you're not really successful. So one thing that's really motivated me, I was actually talking to my friend before this. I'm like, you know, our team are like really cranking, things are in place, and I got so much more freedom. Like I've gone skydiving 3 days this week. I'm probably going to go all day tomorrow as well. I'm like, I got a lot of time and it's just really interesting and things are growing and things are happening. And he's like, how do you do that? I said, well, I follow my planner. Like I follow my planner. So I have this planner that I've followed for years on how I get a lot done. I get very productive and still have a lot of time to have fun. So what we can do is we can send these guys a link and they can download it for free. They can get it and follow this daily planner. It's super cool. But apart from that, look, the only thing I'd sort of just leave you guys on is like, if you're in business, is really analyze yourself and be like, what sort of business owner are you? So there's four different entrepreneurs. One's the visionary. One's the visionary ideas person. I'm a visionary ideas person. I have a trillion ideas, don't know how to implement. Trillion ideas. The ideas person. Next one is the lists or the implementer. So someone who actually loves to implement ideas and create the lists and the spreadsheets and get these things done. Then we have a skilled person. So a lot of people get into business as well because they're just good at a skill. They're like, hey, I'm really good at this thing. I should start a business out of it. Not necessarily, because maybe you suck at business, but you're good at the skill. And then the last one is the hustler, someone who's just got grit. Someone like a Ray Kroc, someone like a Ray Kroc came along to McDonald's with the hustle and the ideas, and he took that thing to the next place. You know, so you got to identify which personality type you are in business, and is that the right personality type that should be in the seat that you're in right now running your company? Or should you employ somebody else to actually be the right person for the right place to put you and use you properly in the company? Or maybe you just need to get out of the way. I have a friend who he says to me, he accidentally built one of the biggest pharmaceutical companies here in Australia, right? He accidentally did it because he brought an idea from America, started it here, has the rights here. Now Chemist Warehouse have bought out like 15% of his company. It's grown huge, it's like a $100 million company. He goes, the biggest liability in my business right now is me. He goes, we've actually had to just get me out of every seat. He's like, it's too big. I know nothing about it anymore. He's like, I'm a liability. So he's not, he gets director's drawings. He doesn't have, he's not on the board meetings. He's nothing. He's like, I just get out. I play golf. Let smart people run it. Right. So every company's getting to a point where maybe you shouldn't be in the seat anymore. So identify what sort of entrepreneur you are, what sort of business you owner you are, and see if you're meant to be in that seat right now. If not, get out, put someone in it so you can take the business to the next level.